Fresh from Tuesday's blockbuster IPO for Monde Nissin, what's next in the pipeline? PSE President Ramon Monzon now joins us live, the very, very busy Mr. Monzon. Hi, sir. Good morning. Thank you so much for the time.
Hi, Mimi. As always, we miss you here.
The feeling is mutual, but congratulations, sir. I mean, Monde Nissin is going to come down in history as an IPO, a historic IPO that happened on your watch. Do you think this is the inflection point where the foreigners give us a second look and they come back?
Well, you know, I mean, IPOs, I guess, do not, I guess, turn around the direction of the market, okay? And then still, you know, investor sentiment, still the perception of the, you know, where the economy is. At the moment, I mean, when you have a market like the Philippine market, really, companies that go on IPOs, make it or break it, depending on their own, you know, I guess, reputation, performance, and prospects. And obviously, Monde Nissin has a very good long-term prospect, which, you know, foreign investors recognize and appreciate. I'm sure you know that of the $1.15 billion of Monde Nissin offered shares in the IPO, more than 60% or 700 million were placed or taken up by just 11. You know, foreign cornerstone investors. So the demand for the Monde Nissin IPO, especially from the foreign investors, were really unbelievable.
So, sir, how many more IPOs are in the pipeline? How many REITs are you looking to list this year, and how many companies are listing through IPO?
Okay, so far we've had two IPOs. Which was the Double Dragon REIT earlier, the first IPO. The second one, of course, is this Monde Nissin. We have one coming up very shortly, Del Monte, which is another 44 billion peso, you know, capital raising activity. We have two REITs scheduled, which is the Cyber Zone of PhilInvest, which plans to raise about 14.9 billion. We have the Robinson's Land REIT also, which plans to raise about 26.7 billion. And then we have a slew of smaller follow-on offerings. We have the follow-on offering of Apollo. We have LBC Express follow-on offering and Certec Holdings. So these are all in the pipeline. Okay. So I guess I can say, you know, the capital raising pipeline for the market this year is fantastic. Okay. Today, after yesterday's Monde Nissin IPO, we have already had $122.5 billion of capital raise in the Philippine stock market, compared to $103.7 billion for the whole year of 2020. Okay, when we had then one of the biggest, or the biggest IPO at that time, which was Converge, as you know.
Converge.
And the first REIT, which is a REIT. Okay, but in spite of that, you know, we're here June 1st now, June 2nd, and we've already exceeded last year's capital raising achievement by almost 20%.
Wow. But Mr. Monzon, interest rates are so low. Is going public or selling shares still the most attractive way to raise funds?
Well, it goes both ways. Obviously, you know, with the liquidity at its high level presently, with interest rates at the lowest level presently, yet if you you look at the BSP statistics, outstanding loans are down. You know, it was down 4.5% in March, down another 5% in April on a year-to-year basis. So you can see that the banks, while they have a lot of liquid funds, have been very, very careful in their lending. So while it might be cheaper to raise debt capital, not everybody, I guess, will have the the access or ability to take out loans at this time.
Okay, sir, I know that around this time you usually come up with the SMIP, the stock market investor profile. Do you have initial numbers or preliminary data to tell us how many more accounts were opened, who are investing?
I don't have the details, but we did come up with a press release on that. We've increased the number of retail investors by another 14%, I believe. Wow. But again, more important than that, more important than look at the details is what has been the mover of the market for this year. Obviously, it's the local investors. From just being 45% of the market in 2019 and 54% in 2020, they're now, local investors now comprise 69%, okay? And on a higher volume, okay? Mind you, on a higher volume of the market. I mean, last year we averaged about 7.3 billion average daily trading volume. To date, we're averaging about 9.16 billion. So, it's about a 28, 29% increase in trading volume. So you've got a bigger market and a bigger share of the local investors. It's the local investors carrying the market. In fact, it's so sad that, foreign investors continue to sell out of the market, okay? To date, we have about 72.9 billion of net foreign selling, okay? Which compares to 128.5 for the whole year of 2020. So we're not even halfway, but the foreign selling is really, more than 50% of last year's foreign selling volume.
Mr. Monzon, I think what could make the interesting a little bit more interesting would be when you launch new products. Short selling, for example, you've been working on this for a long time. Is it finally happening this year?
Oh, thank you for, I hope by, asking me, you're also, able to help me follow this up with the regulators, okay?
Okay.
Well, in fairness to our regulator, I've been regular touch with them. They have their plates full. There are so many things on their plates, okay? I mean, it's just not the Philippine, stock exchange issues that they have on their plate. So I understand, we have to fall in line. Of course, in my view, our concerns are, very, very urgent. But of course, from a broader perspective, it might not be as urgent as the regulators think. But in my latest communication with our regulator, they gave me hopes that this short selling will probably be, approved before the end of the second quarter, okay? And that's what I've been pushing for. There are just three items remaining. One is we need the SEC approval of PDTC as a securities lending and borrowing agent. Okay, we need the approval of the SEC for identified offshore assets to be used as collateral for the foreign, SBL participants. And from the BIR, it's really just their approval of the use of the global master securities lending agreement compared to the, Philippine master securities lending agreement, which the BIR now recognizes. So those are three, not major items, minor items. So it's just a question of, getting time to discuss it thoroughly and, So hopefully with you also hoping behind the scenes, this will be a reality before.
We'll follow up.
Yes.
We will, definitely. Mr. Monzon, we don't have much time. Final question, looking ahead, many are saying, okay, it's interesting to invest in the stock market, but it seems more exciting to be investing in cryptocurrencies. Is this something that you're also looking at? Are you seeing collaborations when, investing in equities and investing in cryptos could actually work together? That you could actually tap cryptos or the blockchain technology at least?
Okay. Well, we've focused on the potentials of the blockchain technology on how it would affect, the market, where we could use it. But as you can see, even on the global development, not too many stock exchanges have been using this blockchain technology. So this DLT could be useful for operations like a depository. Okay, so this digital ledger technology, I think has special, you know, uses. And obviously, we are not a pioneer. We are, you know, we are seeing how this develops among other exchanges, and we will take our cue from there. But again, crypto looks to be a very exciting investment because of the, you know, of the returns. Okay, but you know, as they say, you know, high risk, high return. So yeah, totally different, you know, investment vehicle.
Okay, Mr. Monzon, always a pleasure to speak with you. Hopefully we see you soon in person. Thank you so much for the time, sir. And congratulations, so many milestones under your watch.
Thank you very much.